like an X is sexier than a Z. Like Zay.
You think an X is sexier than a Z? Well, that's just because of the association. No one's like, oh, did you see this movie? I hear it's real triple Z material. That just sounds like it's going to be bad.
Yeah, triple X versus triple Z is, yeah. Can we get real Randy or can we get real Snorri?
Speaking of snoring, I read about this guy, James Joyce.
Well, let's take it back. Thank you and welcome for tuning in to the Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band Good Time Podcast, the only podcast that identifies, biographies, signifies all the figures on the Beatles' 1967 album, Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Today, we're talking about James Joyce. JJ. He has a middle name, doesn't he?
Yeah,
tell
James,
me what you know.
James Aloysius Joyce. He was one of the most influential authors of the 20th century. I feel like we say that about a lot of people, but this is according to multiple sources.
I feel like it's true.
He was born February 2nd, 1882, in Rathgar, Dublin, Ireland. He was the oldest of his 9 other siblings to survive infancy, and that is a qualifier. Oh.
And that's just the ones that survived infancy.
Yeah. During most of his early life, his parents were destitute because of his father's drinking and money spending. Despite that, he did very well in school, eventually going to University College in Dublin, where he studied languages. He was a big fan of Henrik Ibsen and learned Norwegian so he could read his play When We Dead Awaken. He learned Norwegian just to be able to read that play. He was barely 18 when his review of it came out. It was published in the London Fortnightly Review, and this helped convince him that he was on the right career path. The fact that he was getting notoriety for his movie reviews.
Did he write it in Norwegian also? For an audience?
I don't remember. I didn't think that was as important.
Oh, I doubt it. I'm sure it was for his...
He did learn to... I feel like reading and writing are two different things, though, you know? Mm. Mm-hmm. He wrote short stories, novels, poems, and bits of prose, which he called epiphanies, because they were written about moments where he'd have a revelation about someone or something. So aptly named. He's better known as a novelist, though. Everyone's read Ulysses.
Or did they lie that they said they read it?
Yeah.
I didn't read it.
I'll
be honest.
I just said that because I feel like it's obvious that not everybody has read it, and I was being a bit facetious. He loved writing about Dublin. This is a quote. He said, "For myself, I always write about Dublin, because if I can get to the heart of Dublin, I can get to the heart of the cities of the world." That's very cute. In 1930, he was married to Nora Barnacle. They met in 1904, but they didn't get married until 1930. They had a son together named Giorgio and a daughter named Lucia. And there's a movie about Nora. It's called Nora. And it stars Susan Lynch and Ewan McGregor as Nora and James, respectively. Also, if you're lucky, sometimes at auctions you can buy sexually explicit letters that they used to send each other. One of them was sold for £240,800, which is over 309,000 US.
It's a lot.
Just to
smart.
Read some of their... Yeah, some of their sexting messages. James Joyce died on January 13th, 1941, after falling into a coma during an operation on a perforated ulcer in his small intestine. He was 58 years old. Ooh. But yeah, he seemed like a cool dude.
Who do you think chose him?
James Joyce. Well, I feel like Paul McCartney's the only one that reads regular books. George is into Indian gurus, so he's reading a lot of like religious and spiritual texts. I think Ringo reads Archie comics. And sometimes the funnies. And I think that John Lennon just looks at paintings.
I feel like John Lennon's more of the William S. Burroughs sort of type of writing.
Oh, yeah.
Just like cut up a bunch of words and throw them in the air.
Yeah,
and
that,
pick them up
that
one
too.
At a time, and that's a sentence.
Just real abstract. Abstract.
That was a good word.
Abstract. Real abstract bullshit that, you know, he doesn't have to be able to explain. That's the kind of guy I think Lennon is. The more abstract, the better, because who's going to tell him he's wrong? Who do you think picked him?
Probably Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably Paul. Also, like we said in the beginning, get your album out. And if you're looking at it, you might be wondering where in the heck he is. Because all we get on the cover is pretty much just his gray hair. That's really all you get. You don't even get eyebrows.
Let me see this. Yeah, it's like just his forehead.
So it's also questionable that it even is him. We're going with it that it is. So we've had a lot of authors now. We've had, like I said, Burroughs. We've had Poe. We've had H.G. Wells. And that's just off the top of my head. I'm sure the other ones were as well. But those are the ones that stand out to me. We're almost done with the season.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy. I feel like we just started it.
Well, it was a longer one, too.
Were there more people on the second row than the first row?
Oh, absolutely. By four. Four more people. And we hit the brakes a little bit for these last four. Doing one at a time for whatever reason. I like the reason, though.
Yeah, I feel like it's a smoother ride. It's more
like
an NPR.
Yeah, we're in cruise control now. Yeah. We've been speeding along the highway. Honey, I want it my way.
Yeah.
And we just like the weather here in Cleveland, Ohio. Also, let's not forget to say where we are here in Cleveland, Ohio.
Golden Ox. Studios in Tremont.
Studios in Tremont. The cameras are closer than they've ever been.
Yeah, they keep getting closer. You can't. Sometimes it feels like they move when you look away. I can tell that they're zoomed in on me, even though I can't see the lens clearly. I just know. I know when it's zoomed in.
It's been a little while since we've been here, too. I think I don't know if it's been weeks or months or, you know, time's weird.
You know what?
Big analogy.
You know what this studio could use? A taxidermy ox.
Just the face, I don't think the whole ox would fit in here.
Oh, I think it would. It would take up some space, but it would definitely be a statement.
Oh, excuse me. Just gonna skirt by here. Just gonna get behind you.
And you can get
ox
gold leaf
and spray paint it gold.
Oh, yeah, or you could just spray paint. I was going to say get gold leaf and just, like, smother it all over it until it crinkles apart.
Then it's just gold shavings on the bottom.
Yeah.
Underneath it. Dan, we don't have a third guest today. I mean, we always do. We don't have a fourth guest, but our third guest should be introduced. While we were setting it up, I was thinking, do we really want Mae West to talk to James Joyce? I don't know. We still can. What do you think about that?
No, I feel like Edgar Allan Poe would have a better conversation with James Joyce.
Bowen Joyce?
Yeah.
I listened to that. But in the meantime, I did give a prompt to our friend ChatGPT. I told it to write us a short story about Sergeant Pepper himself in the style of James Joyce. And I gave it a whole cast of characters, so we'll see what it does with it. And I told him how to finish it off.
All right, I'm excited.
So we'll maybe go paragraph by paragraph on this, and then we'll do some Poe, and then we'll switch out the Joyce, and we'll pat you on the old buttocks and let you get on with your day.
I don't know what any of that means. I feel like everything that you just said was a colloquialism from a different place.
Amidst the tapestries of time, Sergeant Pepper's forlorn visage stood resolute, a sentinel of the ceaseless parade of existence. His piercing eyes held the secrets of Aleister Crowley's incantations, whispered among the nocturnal mysteries of bohemian haunts. Mae West's sultry laughter echoed through the corridors of his memory. A siren's call beckoned toward forbidden pleasures.
Lenny Bruce's words flowed like a torrential stream, mingling with the timeless wit of W.C. Fields. And there, in the shadowed alcoves, Edgar Allan Poe's Raven still croaked its melancholic verse, while Fred Astaire danced with grace across the ballroom of Sergeant Pepper's thoughts.
Bob Dylan's folk melodies resonated with the murmurs of Tony Curtis, weaving tales of love and longing. Dion's voice carried the rhythm of the streets, a symphony of souls seeking connection. And in the flicker of a candle's glow, Marilyn Monroe's beauty cast a gentle glow upon the canvas of Sergeant Pepper's musings.
Laurel and Hardy's slapstick antics danced in tandem with Karl Marx's philosophic ponderings. A harmonious clash of laughter and ideology. And through the gears of H.G. Wells's time machine, Sergeant Pepper glimpsed the ebb and flow of generations, a continuum of change and consistency.
Yet as the vignettes of these luminaries intermingled with his reverie, the crescendo of their existence was but a prelude. For in the mosaic of Sergeant Pepper's thoughts, their voices converged and harmonized, resonating with a melody that would soon transform the world.
The Beatles emerged from the tapestry, their youthful energy and creativity blazing a trail through the annals of history. With every strum of a guitar, every beat of a drum, they forged a connection that transcended time and space, touching the hearts of generations.
And just as Sergeant Pepper's journey seemed destined for its closing cadence, a shadow fell upon his reverie. A figure cloaked in mystery, known only as Anonymous, materialized on the horizon of his thoughts. A shrouded enigma, Anonymous, bore the weight of untold stories and concealed truths, a presence that defied comprehension.
As Sergeant Pepper's contemplations wove around Anonymous, questions stirred in the depths of his being. Who was this figure, and what secrets did they hold? What tales of wonder and intrigue were yet to be unraveled? The precipice of anticipation loomed, and the tapestries of Sergeant Pepper's musings swirled with newfound uncertainty.
And so, dear reader and dear listener, as the echoes of history reverberate and the enigma of Anonymous beckons, we stand at the cusp of revelation and mystery. The symphony of existence plays on, its chords resonating through the corridors of time as Sergeant Pepper's journey carries us forward into the ever-unfolding narrative of existence. Thank you. funny I should mention Anonymous because, well, that's next week's episode.
Yeah. We need to find out who that hairdresser's dummy, where did that come from?
Who's hairdresser?
Well, I'm assuming it was H.G. Wells's, right?
His hair was fine.
Probably came out of that.
The Beatles had great hair.
Didn't we decide that the hairdresser's dummy came out of that trunk?
Well, you need a trunk. You need a trunk big enough for a person, and a hairdresser's dummy is the size of a person. So
the hairdresser's dummy.
I think it's a suspect to buy a trunk big enough for a person. You know, buying a coffin without it. You know, what do you need this for? Well, let me just buy a hairdresser dummy, and then we got the case, so we can do our time travel. And well, we got this hairdresser dummy lying around. May as well put it on the cover.
Maybe they had to, maybe some of the random stuff is just there to replace the figures that weren't able to be on the cover.
Quite possibly.
Like Gandhi and Hitler. And maybe Jesus, they just, yeah. For every Gandhi and Hitler, you get another Shirley Temple.
Or another hairdresser dummy.
Yeah.
It's going to be a can of worms. We're going to sprinkle on. I don't know how you sprinkle on a can of worms.
Sprinkle a can of worms.
I don't know what you would sprinkle on the can of worms. Some tahini, maybe? Wash it down with some Sgt. Pepper seltzer.
Did worms used to come in cans?
In the beginning.
How would you keep them alive?
Yeah, it's a terrible. That's like a. Yeah, no one puts worms in a can.
Because anytime you ever see a can of worms opening up, they're always squirming around on the top.
And then like a can of whoop-ass? How do you put the whoop-ass in a can?
Easy. You just, anything that says Hormel on the front is going to whoop your ass.
Dan, if you'd be my Poe, I'll do James. And I don't have a very good Irish accent.
Yeah, mine's not great either.
But I'm gonna preface it with that, and I don't mean to offend anyone. This is, of course, this dialogue is fictional, and this podcast is for entertainment purposes only.
In a dimly lit parlor, the spirits of literature's past converged. With my raven perched nearby, I engaged in an intellectual tête-à-tête with James Joyce. Surprisingly, our topic was not the macabre or the cryptic, but the mundane realm of canned goods.
Indeed, Mr. Poe, the modern age has introduced us to the curious phenomenon of canned substance. What peculiar beings we are to encase our nourishment in metal prisons.
Ah, yes, my dear Joyce. Canned goods, a product of our industrial era, encapsulate sustenance and suspended in time. Much like a tale suspended between the pages of a manuscript, they offer a prepackaged experience, much like the narrative awaiting the reader's gaze.
Quite so, Mr. Poe. But don't they lend a touch of absurdity to life? Peas and peaches, ensnared within tin confines, yearning for liberation. It's akin to our existence itself, wouldn't you agree?
Truly, my friend, absurdity is the essence of our existence. The interplay between the mundane and the uncanny, Our narratives are intertwined with the strange, the enigmatic.
You speak wisdom, Mr. Poe. In the mundane and the bizarre, we find our most profound revelations. At this point, a mysterious figure emerges from the shadows, casting an eerie presence in the room.
And who might you be, a phantasm of curiosity, joining our discourse?
Gentlemen of letters, your musings traverse time like threads in a tapestry. Amid discussions of the ordinary and the bizarre, remember that the most ignorant often lie within the intricacies of history.
Ah, the space between that is known as what remains hidden, the true heart of the enigma.
Caw, even my raven concurs. Speak on, mysterious presence. Share with us the secrets you bear.
As your words persist through the ages, remember that the most erudite minds are but whispers in the grand chorus of existence.
In this moment, Poe and James exchange knowing glances, their thoughts intertwining like spectral wisps.
A veil of enigma shrouds you, Anonymous, hinting at tales untold, mysteries concealed, a promise of revelations yet to come.
Indeed. The veil between the known and the unknown, where the heart of true intrigue resides. And so, in that parlor where the ethereal met the intellectual, Poe and James stood on the brink of revelation. The echoes of their words mingled with the enigma of Anonymous, a figure who held within his shroud from the narratives that could reshape their perceptions of time and truth. Well, I don't think he was going to be in that.
What was that story about? Man, the AI is really good at analogies. It explained how canned food is the same as like a trash magazine.
How so?
Disposable prepackaged garbage.
Yeah.
The pages of a manuscript. You didn't say a good manuscript.
Yeah, it didn't say a bad one either. Like just eternal. It's just a snapshot.
Yeah.
Like this is what the worms were like then, you know, when they were canned.
Yeah, that's really good.
Caw, my raven agrees.
Did you tell it to make an analogy between non-perishable canned goods and
So no.
So like people say that AI is theft, but also we just had Edgar Allan Poe talk about canned goods, and he made that real macabre comparison between, like, writing the pages of a manuscript and trapping them between the binding and how the animals are in a metal prison.
The manuscript.
Who is that stolen from? Did someone else talk about how canned goods were, like, trapping things in prisons?
It's a trap. No.
There's no way.
No way.
That's very specific.
Dan, who would we replace James Joyce with? James Joyce. Also, all we have of him is his forehead.
Well, then, Quentin Tarantino. Because if he was in that picture, that's all you'd be able to see, too. That's all you can see when you look at any picture of Quentin Tarantino is his forehead. Or Kelsey Grammer.
Those are both good.
I feel like Kelsey Grammer would be a good James Joyce.
What's another connection there?
Connection?
Yeah.
Pretentious.
He didn't write though.
Drunk. I don't know if James Joyce was a big drinker though. His father was.
Mm-hmm.
But I think James Joyce drank a lot too.
Tarantino's more of a writer.
Mm-hmm.
Than grammar. Kelsey Grammer, that is.
Yeah.
He uses grammar. I like Quentin.
All right. Plus, I like that you can't see his face on the picture.
Mm-hmm.
No one even has to know it's Tarantino.
So yeah, next week, please join us, won't you? To talk about Anonymous, a.k.a. a hairdresser's dummy.
It's going to be more interesting than it sounds.